into the world stage? How do you eliminate that kind of, that fear or that what if this gold was not procured responsibly? Where is the proof? How do I show the world proof? How do I create a new paradigm on top of which anything can be built? For example, if I want to create, you know, a spot exchange that is coming up, it has to be based on gold that is going to be delivered, and that delivered gold has to be, it has to follow fair trade practices, it has to be responsibly sourced. You need to know the origins of the gold which you are buying. So, you know, I think blockchain, especially what we have designed in our paper called Shine, can reliably establish a custody, a chain of custody over gold. From dore to mine to jeweler, securely documenting all transactions across the entire supply chain. So, what are some of the characteristics? Some of the characteristics, basically, it supports participation from all members in the gold supply chain. If you look at my, if you look at the paper, which I can share with you later, basically it highlights who are the different players within the supply chain and how this particular platform can benefit every player within the supply chain. I'm not going to go into details, this is not enough time, but basically it highlights the entire process and how this particular platform can benefit all the players in the supply chain. Now, data transmitted downstream. Like I mentioned, data once stored on a blockchain network or a blockchain system cannot be erased, cannot be tampered with. That is the beauty of this new paradigm that we are seeing right now. And data transmitted downstream at every point, the blockchain can record that data and can show that data live to anybody who would like to see it. A regulator, for example, can know that, can know every gold trade happening within the country, can have traceability for every bullion bar or every piece of jewelry. So basically what blockchain could solve for is using the two C's that I'd like to call it, coordination and contracting, to solve for the two T's that I'd like to call it, trust and traceability. So we are, you know, starting to work with large players, large policymakers in the industry. IGPC has been great help, starting to work with WGC and in talks with one of the leading exchanges in the world to see how we can go about implementing this system to not just create a similar parallel version of a good delivery standard, but a very wholesome platform on top of which any kind of gold trade can happen. So I've already outlined the benefits, but quickly I'll go through the benefits. Reduced smuggling, terror financing, INR outflow. Because you have traceability within the country, there is a strong pitch that could be made to the regulators for banks to participate within the local market. If the banks can participate within the local market, there is very little INR outflow that has to happen. And since it's a closed network of gold that we are creating, this would reduce smuggling, this would reduce terror financing. There's minimal administration and regulation cost for the regulators because they can see in real time all the participants in the system. How do you enhance trade attractiveness of the participants in the network? India gets put on a global stage, which means that this would benefit bullion dealers, jewelers, miners, refiners, all of them in a single system. A brief kind of technology architecture that we had gone through, but I'll go through this later. A small kind of another benefit that we would have, now that you have full traceability, now that you have full accountability for gold, I'll just take a minute extra. Basically, how can the gold monetization scheme be benefited on top of a platform like this? Now, right now in the gold monetization scheme, the flow of material is, so a person has to go to a bank, he has to deposit his gold, he gets a gold savings account. The bank then contacts the refiner to melt that gold. The refiner, so if you look at this, the bank then goes to the refiner. The refiner then kind of melts that gold. Collection, purity and testing centers are there which measures the purity of that gold. That gold gets stored in a vault. Then the gold savings account is opened for the customer within 30 days. Now this is the flow of material that happens, and the flow of data is quite confusing for a customer. So a customer brings in ornaments. He has to enter a lot of data on top of that ornaments. What are the stones that are there? How those should be handled, etc. There are a lot of details that he has to give to the bank, and he ultimately, after 30 days, gets a gold savings account open for him. So there are different flows you have: material flow, data flow, and financial flow. if you create this on a system like what we have proposed, potentially like what has also been kind of recommended in the Niti Aayog report, I think that was on Feb of 2018, was basically looking at, one is how do you revamp the gold monetization scheme through reduced deposits. So right now, I think the minimum deposit is about 30 grams, but how do you revamp that to reduced? You can deposit even 5 grams of gold. How do you, you know, increase the number of banks that can participate in the system? How do you extend the gold monetization scheme to the gold metal loan scheme? And how do you enable, one recommend, strong recommendation by Niti Aayog was also, how do you enable jewelers as well to be a part of the GMS? Now, for transitioning through this to from the old process to the new process, or for transitioning from existing less traceability and less adoption of the gold monetization scheme to transitioning to a new paradigm, we believe that technologies such as blockchain will help enable that through securely sharing data between parties and ensuring a level of trust in the system that hasn't been realized to date. I think we're out of time, so